This is the Dead Air Show. I'm Barry McQuilkin. This is David Bigley. Tonight we'll be talking about how we've produced the show over the past year. We have inserts from all our past shows. We're going to have David Mish sing the Somerville song, Barbara Brandt of the Open Door program, belly dancing, and just a whole lot of other stuff.
Lots of stuff.
Charles Kelly will be here shortly. His tardiness has affected the production of this program in many different ways.
I don't know what we're going to do with that boy.
Yeah. As we'll be talking later on, Kelly was arrested one night. He showed up late for a program, not because he showed up late, but for different reasons. Maybe we can go right into the first cut. Public access means people can come down. Public access means people can come down here and to Channel 3 and make their own programs. We do it. This is a studio. You can just come down and say what you have to say. If you want to run cameras, you can do that. If you want to direct the program, you can do that after a series of workshops. So that's what we've been doing. And a while ago, we invited David Mish down on our program. This is the earliest program we have footage of. It was about, 6 months ago, I think. That's the earliest program. Seven months ago. And David Mish recorded the Somerville song. It was being played on the radio, and so we wanted to get him.
Here.
Charles Kelly arrives.
Right.
Everybody out there?
Tardy as usual. Okay, David Mish recorded the song Somerville, and people didn't know how to react to it. We liked the song. I guess we liked. Do we like the song?
Yeah, it was okay. Yeah,
we liked the song.
Yeah,
I like the song.
I was opposed to motion carried.
And a lot of people in Somerville thought it wasn't
complimentary to Somerville.
Yeah. Right.
Condescending kind of.
Yeah.
After all, there's not a slip shot in my pocket.
And we had David Mish at our concert, Public Access Legal Defense Fund concert, which we'll get into later when we talk about when Charlie was arrested. But and there was a whole controversy started over the Somerville song, and there was a series of letters in the newspaper, and David Mish himself came up to defend, and he wrote a couple of letters in. And so this is the first public appearance of David Mish doing the song on Channel 3 in Somerville. Can you take it?
Roll VTR, standby VTR. Take VTR.
I've been waiting for it.
Wake up, Somerville.
Chamber of Commerce.
You're immortalizing the song.
Yes, this is the song that is on everybody's lip. Hasn't quite gotten to everybody's, both their lips yet, but the upper lips, I believe, of the nation are really talking over this song. Let's see, how can I won't go into a big long introduction. Well, how much time do we have?
Plenty of time.
Well, very briefly, I was inspired to write this song when I saw a TV news story on the city of Los Angeles holding a contest to write, to see who could write the best song about Los Angeles. And the entries were, I thought there were gonna be all sorts of funky songs, you know, from Hollywood songwriters, you know. John Denver would do something. L.A. makes me think of eagles. Of course, almost everything does. You know, something really funky like that. That's why I was so shocked when the actual entries came in. It was just, you have never heard such stuff in your life. Like, Los Angeles, city of the angels. And city of the angels, Los Angeles. And Los, city of the angels, Angeles. Really bad. And I started thinking, if you have a city of 3 million people, and the only thing you can think to write about is the English translation of its name, what would you be reduced to writing about if you had a smaller, slightly less interesting city to write about? Well, that got the old creative sap flowing, so to speak. And the creative sap came up with this. Hi. So glad you could make it for our last show here at the Blue Cheese Room in the Tip Top Lounge. You know, people are always talking and singing about the big cities where they live. San Francisco, where those funny cable cars climb halfway to the stars. Chicago, where you can see a man dance with his wife. Whoopee. But you never hear songs about little towns, places that may not be so important to the map makers, but are awfully darned important to the people who live there. I live in a town like that, a place not too far from here, one that you probably all know, but have never really thought much about. That's why I'd like to tell you about it right now. It may not be like New York and Paris, and London and Rome. Yes, they all have their charms, I agree. But the people who call all those places their home miss something. Just take it from me. Louvre and the UN have beauty. They shine with a kind of a sheen. But far from the Ritz in Massachusetts is a place with the grace of a queen. There is a town around old Boston Bay, a place where time and life stand still. Just follow your nose and heart, and soon your feet will find themselves in Somerville. The city center there is filled with streets. A sub shop graces every hill. You might think you're dreaming, and again, you might not. Anyway, you're in Somerville. Come watch the buildings stand up proud and tall, while far below the pavement hugs the ground. At night, the stoplights change their hue from red to green. Then they change back from green to red. A carnival of color here in Somerville. Too bad that everyone's in bed. A wondrous place where branches hang on every tree, where people go to work and then go home. So come to where the rain and snow fall from the sky, where day is light and night is dark and still. Yes, come watch nature on display. It's always free of charge. That's how it is in Somerville. In Somerville, oh, Somerville, my Somerville.
All right, we're back.
Oh, hello.
Okay, and the second cut we're going to go into is from later on in this program, Henry Gaudette, an 82-year-old wood carver who his greatest talent is he carves things out of one piece of wood. He can carve a chain, he can carve spoons with a ring around it. It's all out of one piece of wood.
Right. So, one piece of wood.
An interesting thing to note about this is we had been wearing lapel mics like these back at that time, and for some reason we were told we couldn't have them anymore. So
Henry had to hold a piece of wood in one hand, microphone in the other hand, and try to talk. And it was
it was a pretty wild audio from that program. This is the one I direct.
I was on camera for this one too, wasn't it?
Yeah.
You actually ran camera through a complete show.
Yeah, this whole show. All right, maybe we can go right into that cut.
You should watch the destructive, ruckus person behind these incredible cameraing. It's all over the place.
Went to Canada one time on a visit, and I saw I had made several lamps. Some of them, not the spiral.
Mm-hmm. How long did it take you to make that, the lamp?
How long did it take me?
Yeah.
Oh, maybe about 2 weeks.
About 2 weeks, really?
Yeah, over 1,000 sticks.
Over 1,000 sticks?
Over 1,000 sticks.
Did you eat all the popsicles?
Popsicle sticks. I then lived on popsicle sticks. That's the reason I look like a popsicle.
Okay.
But I had quite a hard job. Quite a hard job with it. It's a really lot of work. I take a lot of patience.
I guess it does.
A lot of people like to, but of course younger people don't have time. Young people have time. They work, they go to school, they go to college, and they have other things to do. But for me, too much time on my hands. That's my problem. I have to get out. If I'm home, I sit down.
Really, really? You got to
that's
be
a little,
moving.
That's a little gadget.
Yeah.
All kinds of. Out of my crazy head. Then I get tired or it'll go the other way. I really love wood. You know what I mean? There's something about wood that's so fascinating. There's really something about wood that I like.
This is all from one piece, too?
One piece of wood. That red mahogany. That's in one piece. I do it just for pastime.
Okay.
And
can we?
I have a little house of mine.
Let's see above. I don't know if you can get a good shot of the.
You know how to operate that, don't you?
Yeah. And I'll show him. Can you get a good shot of that now? Okay, see above the door. It says peak.
That's a pretty saucy
kid. That's incredible. Somebody these things have moving parts.
The
that's
nerve he's got sticking his tongue out.
That's incredible.
And that was the program with Henry Gaudet and David Misch. The next program, a week later, there were a few developments.
Zipping right along here.
Oh, we got to move. Hey, it's quarter past the hour.
Oh, really? Well, listen, I have to say something.
Okay.
Can I just introduce you?
Oh, sure.
I had supper tonight over at Putnam, at 14 Putnam, and
Bruce Petchek, he's okay.
I had to promise Cindy that I had to give her cooking a plug on the air, and she made just an incredible meal. It was just fantastic, and I just stuffed myself, and it was curried cabbage and this fish stuff with a sour cream sauce with veggies
fantastic.
All over it.
Any leftovers?
Yeah, I think they're saving them for Bruce, though.
Yeah,
so if you get home before Bruce, you can
Bruce
have some.
There.
Yeah, Bruce wasn't there for supper.
Is Dave B there? Hey, Dave B.
Yeah. No, he wasn't.
Oh,
anyway,
okay. Well, who's there?
We can, Cindy and Lois.
Well, I guess that's the word. We all go over to 14 Putnam immediately following this program.
Right, exactly.
All delicious. Too.
Fish and sour cream sauce.
Maybe we should move along. We do have a lot of inserts here. Right, the next program was Bathsheba, the Open Door program. I should say Barbara Brand. Her stage name is Bathsheba. She did some belly dancing. We had a mini belly dance lesson in the program. And an hour before the program, what were you told?
What was I told? I was told that we couldn't direct the program. We couldn't wear the headset, which we had been using for the past, I don't know.
About a month.
Can we show somebody what a headset looks like, by the way, so people can actually know? Can somebody just take it from the camera and send it to us?
Well, a headset is just something that's got a thing on one ear and a little thing in front of your mouth that gets stuck in my whistle.
A really expensive piece of equipment that requires you know, somebody at least with 2 years at Grand Junior College to handle it.
Yeah, well, they told us
at least a master's from BU.
They told us an hour before the program that we couldn't wear this headset. What this meant to us is that we couldn't direct our own program,
right.
Which we have been directing. We expected to direct. We invited Barbara Brand down with the confidence that we'd be directing and things would be under control because we'd have them under control. And we even went out to Bathsheba's Cafe the weekend prior and set up a multiple camera setup, and directed and learned a lot about belly dancing actually.
Mm.
So we felt confident that we could handle this program. So maybe we can run into this cut with Barbara was on the show.
Thank you.
back.
Check on the tube, yeah, I see we're back.
Well, that's how you tell. Okay, that was Bathsheba. I think it was
and
one...
And it's Barbara Brand.
Yeah.
She was very good, by the way. She's really a beautiful person, Barbara Brand.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing that happened during that show is that Barbara Brand is a very, really, really gracious person. She's really just one of the nicest people we ever had in here. And the night for, and the night to thank us for having her onto the show and everything, she brought with her a bottle of wine, a bottle of sangria, was it?
Right.
And it was just one bottle of wine and some cups, and there was, I don't know, we had about a dozen people here because we were all dancing around the studio and just having a good time, and she had a bottle of wine. We all had a little tiny sip of wine, you know.
Yeah, there must have been about 15 of us on that one bottle.
Yeah, it was about, 12 cc's of wine or something.
And, 10 cc's.
They just got all bent out. They sent a letter to the cable board or something saying that we were drunk.
There was a lot of talk about drunkenness that night. I didn't see any. Maybe the one staff was drunk.
Well, they're too busy eating their subs and cokes control the room here. Yeah.
Well.
But it was really a good show, anyway. It was really...
well-staffed.
A lot of fun.
Oh, yeah. Maybe before... Well, the next program we have a cut from is a show where Kelly was arrested. It seems a little weird, the concept of being arrested on television. There's a few things talked about in this sequence that maybe you should be familiar with. The first thing is if the cut's in black and white. All these others are in color. The reason it's in black and white is the record deck somehow got switched to black and white, and that's one of the reasons we feel we'd like to be on all controls here, because... who do you blame if the show ends up in black and white instead of color? You talk about level 3 and level 4 also. Level 3 and level 4 mean running studio camera and directing. Those are like workshop checkout levels you have to get to before you can touch the specific equipment. And all this is in the rules. And the rules being in effect was significant because they told Kelly that he could be back in the studio as soon as the rules were in effect. And that's talked about a bit. And for this program that Kelly was arrested on, they told us we couldn't run the cameras. We couldn't wear the headset, or they had taken away before. Now they told us we couldn't run the cameras anymore because these rules were in effect. North Callahan is the public access coordinator who works for Warner, and Brian Crampton is the executive director of the cable board. So maybe we can go right into that.
What
first
a cast
cut.
Of characters. We're dealing with high competency level people right now, so.
The stage is set.
A little drum roll, a little drama.
A drama opens.
Keep talking.
Oh, well, we don't go right into that. Okay.
What's the problem? They're erasing the tape? They're destroying evidence? They're pretty good at erasing tapes around here.
All right, Brian Crampton was on the phone with North Callahan during the sequence, and there was some agreement that Kelly should be arrested if he wouldn't leave because he...
There was
some kind of an assumption that Kelly had no right to be here and, that they should be arrested. So there was phone calls going on. And the second cut we go into, Brian Crampton actually called the studio line in here. We have a studio call-in thing, but you'll see in a later program, too, where somebody calls in. They can answer... They can ask questions, make comments. If they think what we're saying is nonsense, they can call up and say, hey, it's nonsense. If we have time later on in this program, people can call us up and make just that point.
Hey, 628.
Maybe we can roll right into that cut.
Here we go.
Okay.
It's all set.
Ready in master control?
Stand by VTR. Roll VTR. Take VTR. Take VTR. Take VTR.
This cut's coming up right now, as I understand.
Anytime, this is
here.
Here we go.
Cause it's a burning fire, Southern man. Southern man.
Thanks.
Pool. All right, you'll be back in a little while, you think?
Yeah, right.
Yeah? Okay, go have a cup of coffee or beers or whatever you want. We'll see you in a little while. Okay, tonight there's a giant telephone conference going on right now between NC and BC. which is North Callahan and Brian Crampton, because in the other room, right this very moment, as I live and breathe, this is live television. In the other room is, yeah, right. If you're watching Friday night, forget what I just said. But if you're watching Tuesday night, this is live television, all right? In the other room is Charles Kelly.
Whoa,
right, you can hear the cameraman, right? Charles Kelly is there. Charles Kelly, who... Indeed, indeed. Known and loved by all. Well, known by all, anyway. He's Charlie and I went to Jamaica in December. And as a result of that trip to Jamaica in December, we were late one day with a porta pack. And the porta pack happened to be signed out in Charlie's name. And as a result of that trip, Charlie has been denied access to this studio or to this building at all. He hasn't been allowed in the building whatsoever. You know, not even just allowed to sign out equipment or use the studio or whatever. He hasn't even been allowed in the building, you know. But tonight we managed to smuggle him in. It was through the basement, up the back stairs, and he's here at any rate. Right here he comes. Yeah, sneaking behind the curtain. Here he is. Charles. He's you can't recognize him the way he is right now, but that's really Charlie. Charlie's been told for some unknown reason that he can't be allowed in the studio.
Why should I leave?
What? Wait a minute.
This is history,
Mickey. Wait a minute. We're going to call the who?
You are there.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Brian Crampton's recommendation, eh?
Brian Crampton's recommendation was supposed to call the police.
Well, that's really interesting.
Being the executive director. That was really interesting.
Brian Crampton is the executive director, or was. And right presently, he is no longer in that position.
Well, December 1st, I think he loses his job.
Okay, that position.
He really made a lot work with, did a lot of good things with that position.
Well, that will be discontinued.
It was a dynamic conversation after that. It was just, you know, like a lot of things happened. And finally, they walked it.
Right. Okay, in the second sequence, you see just Kelly and David, and you can hear the police, as you heard North Callahan's voice on that last segment.
Do we have a phone call?
Well, we can't take phone calls now. Maybe at the end of the program.
No, after this we can talk.
But you can hear the police come in and like ask Kelly to leave and try to figure out what's going on here. I mean, the police must have been weirded out because, you know, they're being asked to come and arrest somebody who's just sitting here talking on a television program. This was live. And, well, you can see exactly what happened in this sequence.
Which is coming up any minute now.
Which is coming up very shortly.
Moving along.
Because I'm agreeing with you.
Okay. Excuse me, Brian. Somebody just came in here. North just came in here and said that it was on Brian Crampton's recommendation that Charlie should leave here didn't leave here, that they would call the police. And calling the police was your recommendation. That's the word that I heard.
Well,
Is that true? I may be misquoting somebody. I may be wrong.
Is that your recommendation?
Yeah, you're wrong, yeah.
Who's right or wrong? Is Dave right, what you just said?
Huh?
Is it point your recommendation that you call up cops?
No.
No.
No. It wasn't upon your recommendation.
Only, that's what he was going to do. And I was not aware that you weren't using your own camera.
Watch outside.
And if they have...
Who? Police are outside now.
Who?
Police.
Yeah, I know. I mean, who do you want out here? Who do you want out of the studio?
You want me out of the studio.
You want my opinion?
Well, the police are here, Brian, upon your recommendation.
My opinion is that Charlie Kelly's
dead. Okay,
Well, excuse me, the police are here now.
Brian, the police are here now, and they're asking Charlie to leave the studio. I don't think he should.
I'm not going to leave the studio.
This is a public access channel, and anybody in the city of Somerville has a right to sit in this chair and be on this TV station.
Well, Right.
And if, by calling the police and then asking me to leave, it's censorship. And that's all it is, too.
It's absolute censorship.
It's unadulterated censorship.
This belongs to Warner Cable, this property.
Indeed.
TV is public, not the property.
Well, we are on TV right now. This is a television show right now.
We get the call back on the line.
We have a phone call now. We'll take that in a second. I just want to say that's what happened that night. The program was only about 40 minutes into, and the screen just went to the logo. No audio. The mics were cut. This was totally without our direction. This program was it's required by the FCC that we can have control of being public access producers, and the program just ended essentially 20 minutes early. And people called in and wondered what happened, if Kelly actually had been arrested, and of course he was. The police weren't seen on camera because Warner, again, just took control.
I'm a nice guy. I didn't deserve it. I'm innocent. I didn't do a thing. Who, me? Look at this face.
The wrong place, wrong time. Okay, why don't we...
I even shaved since I last seen
you. Okay, why don't we take this phone call? What do we do?
Push the on button.
Okay. Hello, you're on the air, I think.
Nope, we didn't make it.
Okay.
The number is
628-6750 if you want to call in.
A little rusty in the phone.
We'll be going through a few more cuts here of shows. So after that show, Kelly had been arrested. He had been arraigned in court the next day. We had a program the following week. This program is a weekly program.
Tonight is the exact 8-month anniversary of your arrest. It was the 25th of March, and it's the 25th of November now.
Wow,
that's the exact 8-month anniversary. That's really
well. Well, you got that phone call back again. Let's see if we can nab him.
Well, wait a minute. Let's
nab him.
Okay, let's nab him. Hello, you're on dead air.
Hello?
Hello.
I disagree with you so strongly. You're gonna hit me right with him.
Oh, I remember that guy.
Well, thank you for the call.
Oh,
Steve,
this is truly an anniversary show.
Are you still there?
No, I think
he
got
to
the buzz.
I guess we're hippie riders.
Hey, thank you very much, that young man out there. What's your name, by the way? Rockefeller Mellon or something like that? I don't know who you are.
Okay, so after that, Kelly, you made about 100 phone calls looking for a lawyer to defend the case and
come up with one.
Clyde Brinkstresser, who is Esquire.
Defending or who's handling the case in our what happened since then?
We're going to go into the show where Kelly came back. Well, we went into federal court after losing in Somerville District Court. We went into federal court and got a temporary restraining order saying that Warner couldn't take any control of our program and couldn't arrest our guests who were just sitting there being guests. And this, of course, included Kelly. After Kelly was arrested on this program you saw footage from, he was arrested in the lobby the following week trying to get in here to be a guest. We went into federal court, got a TRO, and a month later he was our guest on the show to talk a little bit about his feelings towards Warner Cable Company and Warner Communications and that whole big conglomerate of what they have. So maybe we can go into that cut, Kelly's return to the Dead Air program.
And, you know, and they come up and they're asking for the, 50% rate increase. And, and the other people are saying, hey, look, buddy, you haven't lived up to your contract. It's not, Warner does not want to live up to its contract. It is giving everything begrudgingly. Mm-hmm. It's like
that's what's amazing to me, that this really big company that's made it as big as they are can come into a town and sign a contract and know from the beginning that they're not going to live up to the contract. I mean, they had to know from the beginning. I mean, they just didn't all of a sudden realize that they couldn't do what they promised they would do. It just seems really incredible that
another quote from the big man. This is in a speech by Al Stern, chairman of the board of Warner Cable, to the National League of City. And he's going, blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. A far more realistic approach would be to acknowledge the existing state of the industry and let us build systems that can adequately provide the public today with whatever services we are capable of delivering at this stage of development. As further advancements are made, .. We will build more capabilities into those systems, and we will increase the number and variety of services offered. In other words, they're saying, let us do whatever we can do to make a buck on, and then later on we'll come in your community and offer the things that the FCC has promised us to begin with, you know? And it's just really a drag, you know? The city just coming in, this place coming in, dragging all these bucks out, you know? They're probably the biggest, you know, they're probably right behind Ma Bell, Edison, and the gas company as far as pulling money out.
Oh, yeah, well, the number two operator in the country. The number two cable.
And we're back. Okay, at this point we started talking about exactly what Warner is. Warner Cable Company of Somerville is one little, well, telephone call. Okay, we'll go and call in a minute. Warner Cable of Somerville is one little company. Just how big is Warner?
Well, Warner Cable of Somerville is a wholly owned subsidiary of Warner Cable of Massachusetts, which is a wholly owned subsidiary of Warner Cable Incorporated, which is a wholly owned subsidiary of Warner Communications, which other wholly owned subsidiaries include Warner Brothers Motion Pictures, which did Blazing Saddles and The Exorcist and Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, and a whole bunch of other really big box office successes. Also Warner Brothers Television, which produced a number of fairly successful series on national television, including Shoulder to Shoulder, the story of the women's suffragette movement. And
I think it was Upstairs, Downstairs, too.
So there's that. They own and publish Mad Magazine. They distribute nationally a number of periodicals, including Playboy, Ms., We, Penthouse, several other magazines. They own and distribute Warner Brothers, Elektra, Atlantic, Cotillion, Reprise, and a number of other labels, record labels that they do. They have a Warner paperback library. They distribute and print paperback books.
Well, you'd say they're financially stable.
Yeah, they're quite stable.
Very good resources.
Well, they make money.
I think the point is made. Warner Cable Company, or the whole thing, Warner Communications, a subsidiary thereof, comes into Somerville, signs a contract, and says, hey, we're going to bring you cable television. It's going to be great. You're going to love it. And they're going to provide public access and all this. And then the reality is they decide that public access costs them money, and they don't want to provide it too much. They don't want to discourage people from coming down. And, well, we don't think that's right. If they sign a contract saying they're going to give it in the first place, then they should live up to that contract. The city has lived up to its part. I think Warner can do it, too. And we're not talking about a little tiny Warner Cable of Somerville. We're talking about a giant conglomerate. Mm-hmm.
Let's go to the phone call.
Okay, why don't we go to the phone call.
Snag that crap.
Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, I just turned in, and I would like to know what the discussion is about.
The discussion is about Warner Cable Company of Somerville Incorporated. Do you a subscriber?
Yeah.
What do you think of your cable television?
Hello?
Hello?
Goodbye.
Goodbye. We're really getting out.
Hey, if there's any other phone calls, 628-6750. If you'd like to make any comment to what we've been saying, I'd like to see how people feel about it. This is one small city, Somerville. Kelly's one person. He comes down here to use public access, and he gets arrested due to the actions of a giant conglomerate like Warner Communications. You gotta wait till it blips.
Yeah, it's blipping.
Blipping.
Two of them.
All right,
we got
a phone call.
Bombardment. We're popular.
Hello, you're on the air.
Yes, I'm calling about Warner Cable. I have it in my house, and it's not too great. I keep calling up and telling them about it, and they say, well, it's in the lines. It'll clear up, especially Channel 9 and 11 from New York. It doesn't come in at all that well, and I keep telling them, but they just keep telling me it's in the lines. I was wondering if there's anything I could do about it.
You can write. You can write to the Cable Advisory Board, tell them that you're having a complaint, you're not getting a satisfactory response from the company. That could help. And just address
write to the State Cable Commission, too.
Right. You just can write one letter, just, you know, short, even a postcard would do, you know, and just, just address it to the Cable Advisory Board, City Hall.
Documented complaints are the only thing that the city or the state or the FCC can act on. You call them up on the telephone and say, hey, my cable TV doesn't work. They can't do anything about it. You need a documented complaint. So I'd say send them a letter. The FCC has guidelines for signal quality. And if you think that the signal you're getting in your cable television isn't of sufficient quality, then, you know, maybe they could, the FCC could come down and monitor it and see if that's the case.
I'd like to ask one more question.
Sure.
You mentioned about Warner Cable being Warner Brothers and all that. I just want to, I guess it's $12 I pay for a month.
Right.
Isn't that $12? What is profit for Warner Cable?
Well, that's really hard to say.
Yeah, it's hard to say at this point. Warner invested a couple $1 million maybe to lay all the trunk line in the city. And it should take them, say, 5 years to earn all that money back. In the next 5 years, it's all gravy. So right now, I don't think they're making a profit. It's like you sign a contract for 10 years. And the first 5 years, you just get back what you put in the next 5 years. And if it's continually beyond, you can make big money.
Well, if you say it's for 10 years and they're making 50%.
Right, but then there's inflation, and right now they're applying
also
for a 50% rate increase.
Warner didn't invest any of its money. Actually, it borrowed money to put into here, so there's a whole deal with that. That is to say, they borrowed the money to put up the system. Like, there was no cash. Warner didn't lay out a dime. They went to a bank and borrowed money there.
Right.
So they're making a little bit more money than that, I feel.
Okay, well, thanks a lot.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you.
Why don't you go 5-1?
Okay.
Just push that.
Hello, you're on the air.
Hi, this is JP from Camera Commons.
All right. Oh, how you doing?
Just fine.
What do you think of your cable TV? Do you have a problem with the signal?
In fact, the signal is, the middle's coming out right now.
Yeah.
Oh. I mean, the picture's really getting crummy.
That's my base on there.
Yeah.
Yeah, Channel 3 has always had the worst signal of the 15, 20 channels around the box. That's because it's public access, I think.
Yeah.
So what do you think of all this, Warner arresting Kelly? You know, a big conglomerate like Warner deciding that Kelly can't be here.
Yeah, well, that's, Warner really doesn't have the right to do that. I'm sure you're going to prove that in court. I wanted to ask you guys a few questions about Warner's new services. My mother heard from the Warner representative in Medford that they were going to offer movies and stuff.
Yeah.
Like over, the system where you get to pay them.
Right.
And
the pay TV thing.
Yeah, she said that the Warner representative told her they were going to show obscene movies.
Now that is, yeah.
I think you're lucky to get what you got right now. I wouldn't expect very many.
I think Teleprompter is doing that right now. They're
in New York.
Teleprompter is the biggest cable operator in the country. Warner is second largest. I think Teleprompter is bouncing signals off satellites to individual systems, and they have sports, movies, and things that you have to pay individually for. I don't know if Warner is doing it in any of its systems yet, but I think that's one of the future developments in cable. Will be to put in, the extra money-making things, banking by your cable too. So there's a lot of room for profit in the future, definitely.
Oh yeah, there's an enormous room for profit. I mean, you can make cable has just opened the doors for a lot of. A company like Warner, if there were some statements in their annual report that were just amazing, where Stephen Ross, I think his name is, was the chairman of the board or something, was just in their annual report when they apply for a rate increase in Somerville, they keep saying, oh, we're not making any money, poor mouth, we're broke, we put out all this money and we didn't get anything back, But when they write their annual report to their stockholders, they come, oh my God, $48 million this year, and we got all these $1 million hanging over here, and we got this is going good for us, and this is going good, nothing but blue skies heading our way, And that's the one to be believed, is what they're saying to their stockholders. And
Right. There's
just an enormous amount of money to be made in cable.
Also, when they came up to the recent, on the city level, and he came in front of the alderman?
Yeah.
Or whatever, they came up and it was discovered that they're actually something like X number percent ahead of the original projections. That is to say, like they said they're going to have like 8,000 subscribers by this point, but now they have 10,000. And you also notice that they really are cutting back on their, the outreach going on to the community and say, hey, let's get the cable together. When
yeah.
they first came into the city, they got something like, I don't know, how many thousands within the first few months. So Warner knows what they're doing, and that is trying to take us for every buck we got.
Yeah, well, the key to profit in cable is penetration. If they said originally they're going to have 17,000 subscribers by, 10 years, 1983, 84, whatever it was, big number, 84. And they came to the rate increase hearing and said, we're only going to have 10,000 by 84. well, you know, what's the problem? They changed their original projections for the, you know, they changed their figures so it looks like they need an increase. And the board was quite wary of this move, and we blew their figures apart, I think, at the hearing.
Well, I think there's something, if anybody in Somerville, if you're watching, you'd like to know more about Warner, what Warner is, write to Warner Communications, 75 Rockefeller Plaza in New York City, and ask for a copy of their annual report and also a copy of Form 10K, which is the form that they have to file with the Securities and Exchange Commission. And it lays all the numbers down in front of you, and the numbers are about this long. There's the numbers of zeros and zeros and zeros goes off the page about what they're, just exactly what they're doing and who owns what and what kind of stock Warner owns in other companies. And the whole financial trip of Warner is right there in one little concise package. So it's 75 Rockefeller Plaza, and it's in New York, New York, and it's their annual report and also Form 10K, which is what they have to file with the Securities and Exchange.
Just for a little interesting note, the biggest stockholder of Warner Cable Communications, or one of the major ones, is First National Bank in Boston. You know, they're one of the biggest shareholders of Warner Communications.
Goes around from Boston and New York and back here.
And round and around we go.
Let's go. JP, thanks for calling.
I've got a question.
Okay. Would
this be their first rate increase? Have they yet received the rate increase?
This would be the first in Somerville. And I think it would be the first in the history, well, for any Warner system in the state.
Oh, in the state. They've received rate increases in something like, they have about 140, this is as of their 74 annual report, they have like 145 systems throughout the country, and they've received rate increases in over 90 of them, wasn't it, 97 of them or something? I forget the exact figure.
Over 75%.
They have received, and this is what they're saying, you know, and these projected rate increases that we are sure to get all over the country, we're just going to make you more and more money, you know, as they're talking to their
stockholders,
you know, so right. You know, they're making lots of money.
Okay, well, JP, thanks for calling. We got another phone call now.
Okay,
we'll see you later.
Stay
on.
Easy, JP.
Right. Bye-bye. Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, before we go to cable TV, our television looks good. Now since it's a cable, you know, we've been having a lot of trouble, and I'm not worth the money that we pay for it anymore.
Well, they're asking more money. They're asking 50% more than what you're already paying. So
do you
want to
pay more for it?
You're paying.
Huh?
Do you want to pay more for it?
Yeah.
No, you want more for what you're paying, I think.
Yeah.
But
they're
applying for a rate increase of 50%. You're paying $5 a month now for a single TV. They want to raise that to $7.50. The city didn't like the idea, and they refused them, and they've appealed to the state level. So it's conceivable that they could be asking you in the next few months to pay $7.50 for the same service you're getting right now. How do you like that?
I don't think it's worth it, because before we got this cable, it worked real good. But now, since we put it in,
Whereabouts do you live?
Whereabouts?
Yeah, you don't think it was the exact address.
No, West Somerville.
West Somerville, eh? Oh, that's where I'm from. I know what you mean.
Wait, well, we got another phone call. Hey, thanks a lot.
Hey, thanks a lot.
Okay.
All right, bye-bye.
Keep it moving. No.
The other one. Just push 5-1.
5-1.
Let's see.
Five one.
Yeah.
Hey,
okay,
got it.
Hello, you're on the air.
Hello.
Talk.
Put it on. Hello. I guess we lost him.
Did we?
Okay. Well.
Okay.
Okay. The number is 628-6750. If you want to call, maybe we can go into get into another topic.
I'm on the lights still on.
Okay. While we're talking about the dimensions of Warner, the size of the big W. I think that this is probably an appropriate time to talk about in our involvement with Kelly being arrested. I mean, here's this company comes in and just says, "Well, you're under arrest for trespassing in our public access studio." We've of course appealed it in court, and when you get into court routines, there's just an enormous amount of paper involved. There's lawyers' time involved. There's just a big expense involved, and we have set up the PALDF, which is the Public Access Legal Defense Fund. And if anybody is interested in finding out what's going on with the PALDF and where you can send contributions if you're into sending contributions, or just finding out more about exactly the circumstances involved and how the case is progressing, how can they do that? You can call me, or you can address mail to me at my house, or you can call.
Okay, 14 Wesley Street, that's the address of PALDF.
Yeah, you've got another buzz.
Okay, 14 Wesley Street in Somerville, send your donations, send your letters, send your comments, and we'll
keep those
posts
going.
Hello, you're on the air.
The radio man!
Yeah, the radio man's back.
Okay. It's
hello, you're on the air.
Hello.
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 Yes, I was wondering if I could ask a question.
Sure.
As far as Warner, 50% increase, do they plan on having any more stations put on?
No.
At this point, they haven't guaranteed anything new.
No, that's it.
For the radio.
There's not going to be any more new stations. 9/11 is only two promised.
An interesting point in that question is the same time they came around with the rate increase, they also, the same letter that was said they were going to have the rate increase, they said channels 9 and 11 would now be available. Well, channels 9 and 11 were guaranteed in the original contract, which was written up 2-3 years ago. And now they come around and say because, well, they don't really say because, but they tell you at the same time that you're getting 9 and 11 that they need a rate increase to cover their additional costs. You know, of course, we don't feel they need the rate increase, but I don't think they've guaranteed any new services.
I'd like to make a point about channels 9 and 11. You know, what are you getting channel 9 and 11? You're getting old reruns. You're getting no local kind of programming, nothing really pertinent. You know, you just get, it's like channel...
56,
yeah, exactly. You know what I mean? Just old movies numbers. And reruns. Like, matter of fact, in one channel, they have I Dream of Jeannie twice in a row. I mean, that's once is enough. You know, two times in a row?
Watch The Untouchables four times a day.
Really?
Great.
Hey, you can Star Trek, you know, you can watch it. You can watch one half and watch the other half.
Well, you can become an authority on the Prohibition era, maybe.
Through the eyes of Elliot Ness.
To tell you the truth, I'm of the persuasion that all this old programming isn't that bad when you consider the new stuff that they're putting on prime time. I mean, it's just cops and robbers and people getting shot up, you know, 3-4 hours a night. I think the old shows, at least people don't get killed as often. Maybe that's better.
Can I ask one other question other than this? It hasn't nothing to do with Warner Cable.
Sure.
It has to do with another, it's NBC.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I don't know if you want to get into it or not, but...
Sure.
Well,
we have 5 minutes.
I don't know, this may sound a little funny, but I was listening to a radio show the other night, and they had the NFL football game on. I think it was the Oakland Raiders against somebody. And it went into overtime, 45 minutes. And they're supposed to show a children's program on at 7 o'clock, Willy Wonka.
Right.
And... they just picked up from where the football game left off, right in the middle of the show. And they had this real big, you know, appeal to all the people that to call up and have a vote for Willy Wonka or the football game, and it was something like 62-1 for Willy Wonka. You know, I was just wondering if there was anything, you know, that could be done, if anybody could write anything to, I know you can write to NBC, but, you know, how would you go about writing something like that to NBC, and where would you send it?
Okay,
I think your best bet would be right to the FCC, wouldn't it?
Well, no.
The
FCC came to town just about a month ago, and they kept on saying again and again that the government should not be telling the television stations what to do, how to present programming, how to censor programming, when to stop them and start them. And I think that's a good idea, though the FCC may be timid. I think the only thing you can do is send a letter to NBC. They have to be responsive because they want to sell products. They sell products to their viewers. Their viewers got to be happy. So I think the only thing you can do is send letters to the NBC, and they're call up information. They can tell you where they're at.
Yeah. One other thing. Warner Cable, did they make It's a Mad, Mad World? I mean, Warner Brothers?
I don't know.
Well, you see, like, what happened was that Warner Kinsey Corporation bought Warner Brothers 7 Arts.
Yeah.
And so they bought all their previous films. They own that film. If it was made by Warner Brothers, they own it now.
It's just a thing, because, you know, like, in the movie, all the money's buried under the Big W. You know?
Yeah, right, sure.
That's true.
That's right.
I got that right idea. Yeah. That's
the only way to California to find the Big W. What?
That's really good.
Thanks a lot yourself.
Hey, good night, thanks for calling.
Hey, one more call.
Hello, you're on the air.
Hello, Dennis?
Yeah.
Dennis is one of the best programs. And I like all these kind of like speeches that you have on. Dennis is really a terrific program. And I thought there was a race in to get that guy out of the TV show.
You think it was what?
No, I said, I don't think it was race enough guys to throw that guy out.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
It's a good vote of confidence.
Always happy to get
phone
calls.
Hey, we love to hear phone calls like this.
This is the anniversary show as of, actually it was about... What?
Anniversary
show? Yeah, we've been on for a year.
Can you imagine that? A whole year.
I like that year.
Hey.
Oh, thank you.
We like you too.
Maybe you can come on sometime.
Yeah, you want to come on sometime and talk?
We
could have a whole hour of this. You're just lauding us.
We love it. We love it. We need it.
Yeah, keep it up.
You're our sponsors.
Yeah.
Sponsors?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, subscribers actually pay, you know, what they pay supports public access.
I really don't like about these programs being put on time and time again. I mean, I like these programs, but I wish they could make some new ones out of them.
we'll try to bring something new to you every time.
Hey, next week on this program, Mystic Housing Tenants Association, they've promised to tell all. So I'm sure you should.
Tell all about it. Tell about what's going on in the Missing Housing Project.
What's the Missing Housing Project?
Not the Missing Housing Project.
No, the Mystic. Mystic Avenue, the project's down there?
Right.
Yeah. Hey, thanks a lot.
You're welcome. And I'll talk to you again. Goodbye.
Bye. Yeah, I guess we have to call it a wrap.
Well, we have one more phone call. Can we take another phone call?
Yeah.
Yes or no?
Well, it's not 9 o'clock yet. Sure, let's slide.
Okay, we got. Oh, yeah, we're not going to be able to do the end. Okay, one more phone call. It's got to be quick. Hello, you're on the air. No, you're not. Okay, you're on the air.
Listen, we have to talk about Pop Warner.
Pop, well, I'm
sure, great. Quick.
Hey, 30 seconds. You can say what you want about Pop Warner.
Last night, they called up my house, asked me to buy weekly magazine, Pop Warner, and would I be interested in 25 cents a week? So I said, yeah, okay. Now, tonight they called up, told me to send $12 for the year to some place in New Jersey, which Pop Warner's syllable has to do with
I don't know if Pop Warner is associated with Warner Cable. My first impression is that it isn't. But, you know, if I think you should write a letter of complaint just saying, hey.
Well, I was wondering if there was a drive in Somerville, for Pop Warner, or whether this is a phony.
Well, no, I think Pop Warner is a national organization.
Yeah, it is.
They get money to set up a team or a whole bunch of teams in Somerville from a national council. It's like the YMCA kind of, or the Boys Club, or the Girl Scouts or Boy Scouts. They're national organizations, and I think maybe the national headquarters is in New York, in New Jersey.
Yeah, that imagine the person over the phone to send $12.
Yeah, I'll check them out. I checked them out if I were you.
Hey, we have to go. Hey, thank you for the call.
Hey, really? Thanks for tuning in Dead Air.
Yeah, it's 9 o'clock. Hey, thanks a lot.
Bye-bye. Well, we have to call it a wrap.
This is our anniversary show. We've got to end our wrap. We didn't get into all the cuts. Maybe in a future program we'll get some more cuts from old programs and talk a little bit more about the cable issue, how people feel about it. So for David Bigley,
let's go for a long shot.
And Charlie Kelly, and our new director for this program,
Bob Mataran. Bob Mataran, our man behind the plan.
Mary Tisio and Terry Sonyago on cameras. Good night.
And Kevin Crane in the corner.
Hey, Kevin Crane, give Kevin Crane a hand here. B-I-Bo, 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 da-da-da.
Good night, everybody. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to us. Happy anniversary to...